Serial killer John Paul Knowles, known as the Casanova Killer, is an American serial killer who is linked to 18 murders committed in 1974, but likely murdered 35 people across multiple states after his fiancée broke off their engagement. This guy commits murders inconsistent from one another and with varying methods, which is very unusual for a serial killer. Let's do this. Hi there, my name is Misha, and my channel is called All Things True Crime. If you enjoy this video, please take a second to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell so you won't miss new content. That's All Things True Crime. All right, let me pull up this guy's picture. Paul John Knowles is born April 25th, 1946, in Orlando, Florida, to parents who just didn't care. He has four older siblings, two brothers and two sisters, and the family lives in a three-room residence. He later admits that the worst thing to ever happen to him is just being born. His father is an abuser, and the children suffer his wrath at his hand. By 8 years old, Paul is committing petty theft crimes. He gets caught and, per his father's wishes, spends time in foster care. Now, keep in mind, that's not the purpose of foster care. Parents can't just send their kids to foster care because they suck as parents and the kid is acting up. By today's standards, and probably by that day's standards, Paul and his siblings should have been taken away from their parents. He continues to have run-ins with the law and ends up being sent to Florida State School for Boys. Unfortunately, it seems this place is something you would see only in a horror movie. Boys are sent there for lots of different crimes, usually serious, sometimes not. These boys are allegedly abused by the staff, with a report reading that of the 300 boys there at the time, more than 80 died while in custody. Since the early 2000s, hundreds of men have come forward to recount truly awful stories, gruesome accounts of abuse, and beatings they suffered at this hellhole of a facility that didn't even close until 2011. What's scarier is no one knows or is sharing where those 81 bodies of those boys are buried on the property. Yikes. The Florida State School for Boys opened in 1900 and was called the Florida State Reform School. It's set on 1,400 acres west of Tallahassee. Those bodies could be anywhere. It has always been known for harsh conditions and brutal treatment of the boys in its care. Despite constant reports of commissions being created to review the school, nothing ever changed. I'm talking random, brutal beatings and psychological treatment. These men that are recounting their time say they were under constant anxiety of not knowing when it was going to happen next. One account, this guy says he was startled awake by staff at 2 a.m, rushed to one of the abuse rooms, thrown onto a bed and tied to it before beating him with a leather belt or strap of some kind. These boys were beaten so badly and for so long they would pass out from the pain. Others counted over 135 whippings in one session. Whippings that would lift the boys off the bed a foot and a half. Beatings that would hit the boys so hard the staff member's shoes would slide on the concrete floor. What fresh hell. I digress. At some point, Paul is released and resumes some normalcy of life. When he is around 18 or 19, he's pulled over for a traffic violation. He responds by abducting the police officer and holding him hostage, which doesn't end well for him. He's put in prison for this, but is soon released. I have no idea why. It's a bad call. At this point, he develops a pattern of being in and out of jail pretty constantly for the next 8 or so years, all petty crime and short stints in jail. In early 1974, he's serving time in Florida State Prison when he begins corresponding with a woman in California. She's married, but is in a rocky relationship, so she opens herself up to Paul. They are pen pals who plan to get married once he's released. She helps pay for his lawyer's fees and is excited to start their life together. Once he's released, he travels to San Francisco to finally meet her in person. She is immediately afraid of him, claiming he has an aura of fear about him. Apparently, a psychic warned her of a new dangerous man in her life. As a result of her feelings and this psychic's warning, she calls off their engagement and renews her decision to fix her broken marriage. Devastated, he wanders the streets of San Francisco and murders three people, thus kicking off his infamous murder spree. He then hops on a commercial flight to Jacksonville, Florida, where he gets into a bar fight and stabs a bartender. He's thrown in county lockup where he picks the lock and escapes. Okay. He's resourceful. It's July 26th, 1974. That very night, he invades the home of a 65-year-old lady named Alice. He ties her up and gags her while ransacking her house looking for cash before finally stealing her car. While he doesn't intentionally murder her, she eventually chokes to death on the gag that he shoved in her mouth. Even after her death, he stays in town, driving her car until police link him to the home invasion and his pictures plastered all over the news. At this point, he's panicking and scrambling for a place to ditch her car. While cruising through various residential neighborhoods, he stumbles upon and begins spying on an 11-year-old girl named Lillian and her 7-year-old sister named Mylett. He recognizes them as his mother's friends. Odd. It's likely his mother and her mother were friends instead of his mother being friends with little girls. Anyway, remember, he is panicking by this time, and paranoia is setting in. He is convinced the girls saw him driving down the street and would see him on television and report it to the police. So he kidnaps them, strangles them, and then dumps their bodies in a swamp right outside of town. The next day, he is in Atlantic Beach, Florida. He breaks into a lady's home. Her name is Marjorie. He proceeds to strangle her with her nylon stocking before stealing her television set. Okay. He then stumbles upon an unnamed female teenage hitchhiker. He rapes and strangles her during his travels as he wanders north. Next, he invades the home of a lady named Kathy. He grabs her phone cord and strangles her with it while her 3-year-old son watches. He leaves the child unharmed. A week and a half later, he makes it to Lima, Ohio, where he meets a man named William at a tavern he stops at. They share a few drinks, and somehow one thing leads to another, and William finds himself strangled and dumped in the nearby woods. Paul steals his wallet containing cash and credit cards in his car. From there, he takes a road trip to Sacramento, then through Utah. He stops briefly in LA, Nevada, just long enough to give in to his psychopathic urges and murder two campers, Emmett and Lois, on September 18th. Freaking nutso. I mean, what in the hell? About 3 days later, he's driving through Sequin, Texas, when he spots a woman stranded alongside the road. Her car is broken down, so pretending to be a good Samaritan, he stops to help her. Instead of helping, he rapes her, strangles her to death, and for some reason, only God knows why, drags her body across a tangled up barbed wire fence. What a sick dude. 2 days later, on September 23rd, he is in Birmingham and meets a lady named Anne, who is a beautician. She is attracted to him, as most are. He is an attractive and charming fellow. She agrees to travel with him, so they embark on whatever in the heck that is. I mean, you meet a stranger and immediately agree to just hop in their car and travel.
Yeah.
Okay. So at her expense, literally her financial expense, she paid. They travel around until September 29th, so a whole 6 days, at which point Paul is just sick of her, so he murders her. Her body has never been found. He continues driving, making his way through Oklahoma, Missouri, Iowa, and Minnesota. He supposedly doesn't murder during this time and while in these states, but I find that really hard to believe. I'm guessing he did, and authorities just don't know. So it's now October 19th, and no reported bodies connected to him. Although his MO is constantly changing from victim profile to weapon to motive, so who knows who he's murdered and when. Supposedly, at this point, he is itching for another murder, and he's in Woodford, Virginia. He randomly breaks into the home of a lady named Doris. While looking for money to steal, he finds her husband's rifle and uses it to shoot her in the head. He wipes his prints off the gun before placing it right next to her body. Now, this one baffles cops, as do most of his crimes. This one, because they find no motive. She wasn't raped, nothing was stolen from the house, so it seems he literally just needed a fix. He needed to murder someone to temporarily fulfill that sick desire. What a scumbag. Next, he finds himself in Key West, picking up two hitchhikers. Of course, his plan is to murder them, but instead, he is stopped by a cop for a traffic violation. The cop is apparently unaware of who he is and lets him go. This freaks him out, though, just getting stopped. Freaks him out just enough, and he drives the hitchhikers to Miami and lets them go unharmed. After dropping them off, he calls his lawyer for advice. He's advised to surrender, which he refuses to do. He decides instead to tape a confession of all of his murders, or a number of his murders, and meet his attorney just long enough to pass it off and then skip town before the cops get wind and catch him. November 2nd, He picks up and then murders two hitchhikers, a man named Edward and a woman named Debbie, and he dumps them in the woods. It's now November 6th, and he's in Macon, Georgia. Somehow, he meets a man named Carswell, who invites him into his home to spend the night. While drinking, he stabs Carswell to death and then proceeds to strangle his 15-year-old daughter. He tries to have relations with her corpse, but he fails. I'm sure that really pissed him off. These guys don't like to fail. So by November 8th, he's in Atlanta and is painting the town red, just bar hopping and just having all kinds of fun. So one night while bar hopping, he meets a British journalist named Sandy. He impresses her with his good looks, no surprise, as I mentioned earlier, and so they spend the night together. And once again, he fails in the bedroom department. They spend the next few days together, and he never can get it up. So from a psychological perspective, it would seem to me he's only able to perform for unwilling companions. What a sick scumbag. They split a few days later. However, he finds and picks up one of her friends, a lady named Susan. He pulls a gun on her and demands that she have relations with him. Somehow, she escapes, finds a cop, tells him. The cop approaches Paul, but Paul pulls out his sawed-off shotgun and manages to escape. In West Palm Beach, he decides to do another home invasion, this time a lady named Beverly. She is an invalid. He abducts her sister and steals her car. The next night, he lets the sister go in Fort Pierce, Florida. A cop recognizes the stolen car the next morning, pulls him over. Once again, a gunfight ensues, and he takes the cop hostage. He steals the patrol car with the cop inside. He uses the sirens to make a guy pull over. He then steals that guy's car with the cop and now this guy named James as prisoners. He handcuffs them both to a tree in Pulaski County, Georgia, and then shoots them both in the head at close range. Yikes. Later, he attempts to drive through a police roadblock, at which point he loses control of the car and crashes into a tree. He flees the scene, and a foot chase ensues. Shockingly, he is detained by a Vietnam veteran civilian on November 17th. While in custody, he confesses to 35 murders. However, police can only confirm 18. That doesn't mean much, though, right? Especially since he seemingly murdered at random with such chaotic methods. There's not much to track, I would guess. So he was on the run for 5 months, drove over 20,000 miles and through 25 states. He is charged with 7 counts of murder, although they suspected at least 12, eventually confirming 18. The next day, November 18th, he is being transferred to a maximum security prison when he makes a move for the sheriff's gun. The accompanying FBI agent draws his pistol and shoots him dead right there. Boom. Dead sucker. Paul discharged the sheriff's gun, and while the sheriff struggled to keep the car on the road and his weapon holstered, the FBI agent pulled his gun and shot Paul 3 times in the chest, killing him instantly. Good riddance. So back to his kill tapes for a minute, the ones he gave his attorney. Apparently, he was hoping that after he died, the tapes would make him famous, and somehow his mom would get rich off of it. Twisted way of taking care of his mom, and it didn't work. Yikes. So after his death, the police get wind of the tapes, and they try to get them from the attorney. Now, the attorney claims lawyer-client privilege. The dude's dead, and he's a prolific serial killer. Why are you acting so crazy? Anyway, the lawyer and his wife get arrested and jailed for contempt of court. They eventually get the tapes, the cops do, and confirm that he raped and murdered women and men across Florida, Georgia, Ohio, Nevada, Texas, Virginia, and Connecticut. What a psycho. If you enjoyed this video, please take a quick second to subscribe to my channel, All Things True Crime, and hit the bell so you won't miss my next video. I upload on Tuesdays. Next week, I am remaking my very first serial killer video about Gary Ridgway. The video had too many audio issues, so time for a redo. Ridgway, known as the Green River Killer, is an American serial killer who murdered 71 teenage girls and women in Washington State in the 80s and 90s, making him, by proven murders, the second most prolific American serial killer, and by possible victims, the most prolific American serial killer ever. Yikes. Until next time, stay safe.